Joining us on the Inspired Execution podcast is founder, entrepreneur, and investor Jyoti Bansal. Jyoti is not your average Silicon Valley visionary. He sold his company AppDynamics to Cisco for $3.7 billion. Today, he runs three companies at the same time. It's no wonder he's being named Entrepreneur of the Year by Ernst & Young. Today, Jyoti shares his journey on building multiple unicorns, tips for staying energized while balancing many roles, and the importance of being mission-driven versus money-driven. Jyoti, welcome to the podcast. Thank you for being here.
Great to be here, Chet.
So I cannot help but start with your track record because, wow, right? You've started multiple unicorn businesses, which we'll talk about, but you're also currently running multiple companies, right? How do you do that, right? All at the same time, be energized. Give us a sense of, you know, what does your week look like? How do you divide your time? How do you get energized to make that happen?
Sure. You know, a lot of people ask me this question. You know, it all comes down to if you're almost a cliche that if you are enjoying what you do, it doesn't feel like a job. It's just something you enjoy. That's your passion. That's what you know, you do for fun. You know, so when I sold my first company, AppDynamics, I tried to retire. And everyone was like, oh, you should retire now. Why do you work anymore? And I said, okay, that makes sense. Like, I should retire. And I tried to do it. And after 9 months, I realized, like, you know, I don't really like too many things. You know, I don't like playing golf too long. I don't, you know, I can sit on a beach, but not for more than a few days. This is what I like to do, like building companies, building products, you know, the hustle and bustle of the startup. So that's almost like, you know, that's like, you know, many times people are like, you know, I'm going to do something. And then when I retire, then I'm going to really do something that I enjoy. Like I look at, you know, I'm fortunate that I'm doing now what I enjoy. So that makes it much more easier. And that's what drives the energy and, like, you know, you're enjoying what you're doing, right? Then a lot of people ask me the question, what you ask, like, and how do you manage your time? You know, how many hours, et cetera, you know, and what? I look at it slightly differently. I don't look in terms of, like, you know, how many hours I'm spending where. I look at it in terms of, like, you know, almost like an instead of time allocation, like impact allocation, like where can I make more impact? Like, you know, and the impact can change. Like, you know, sometimes, like, you know, there's something that's so impactful going on in you know, in the company that you have to put a lot of time and energy on that. And you can move the needle either this way by doing it well or by not doing it well, you can move the needle this way as well. Like, you know, so that's where you put time and energy. And that's where how I look at, like, you know, where is the most impact? Like, you know, the impact and, you know, the depends on the stage of the company, the impact could be different.
Yeah, that's a great perspective, by the way. Let me go back to the first comment you made, right? At the end of the day, it's about liking and loving what you do, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, and my general take on your comment is, I think it's, if you didn't like something, if you were not in love with something before, you're not going to fall in love with carpentry or golf after, right? You have to have that passion long before you retire. You cannot say, I'm retired and now I'm going to have a passion, right? Because you either have it before because you're not going to have it after. It seems like you agree.
Sometimes people do. Like, you know, sometimes people are like, you know, I'm working on this and once I make enough money, I'm going to go and open a bar because that's really what I enjoy.
Correct.
Like, you know, and which is also reasonable and valid, right? You know, in my case, that's not the case. Like, you know, what I'm doing is what I want to do when I retire as well. So that makes it a bit easy.
I agree. As I tell folks, the day I retire is the day I'm not vertical, right? I think that's the best way to put it because if you're doing what you love, I think it just works out really well. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like your second comment a lot about impact because I think a lot of folks who have run companies think of it like, you know, I am the CEO. I've got to spend X time on marketing, X time with customers, X time on sales. I certainly think that every leader, whether they are a senior executive or an executive or a manager or a coach, you should always think not about I need to do one-on-ones, but where do you have impact based on the team and the strategy and the stage of where your project or company is. So it seems like you're applying that across the board.
Definitely. To me, it's like the time you can be spending time on things where it won't make any difference. Like you spend 2 hours on something and did it really make any difference if you didn't do that? Like positive or negative difference. So I put everything in that framework. And yes, like, you know, I always have a rough framework. Like, you know, the two areas that I like to make sure I'm spending enough time for both my companies. One is product, because I am a product guy fundamentally. you know, that's my passion, and I definitely like to be in the thick of the product. And second is customers. Like, I have to talk to customers myself and spend some time, because it's impossible to design the right products, even think about your sales, marketing, overall strategy in any ways, unless you don't have a, you know, direct connection, direct link, direct conversations with customers. So those are the two things I feel like, you know, I have to do those, you know, if those happening, and then like, then I have enough going on, and then I can figure out where do I make the most impact.
No, that's awesome. That's awesome. So let's start a little bit with your journey, right? Your first company, AppDynamics, was acquired by Cisco for $3.7 billion. And a lot of people who have been on, aspire to be like you, will say, oh my God, your happiest moment was probably when, you know, the check cashed, or when Cisco announced that they were acquiring you, right? And having gone through with some of this, my take would be that was probably not the most magical moment of your journey, right? So what was it, right? Can you pinpoint to a couple of moments, because there are many, right? You cannot say there was one moment that made the company. What are a couple of moments that you remember that you know, just like touched your heart and that made a difference to you and the company?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. You know, when the company exits, like, you know, it was a big acquisition for us, $3.7 billion. But that was like, you know, a very bittersweet moment. Like, you know, you're happy, but you're sad. You're sad because almost a big chapter in your life is over. Like, I spent like nine years of my life, like, you know, day in, day out, you know, blood, sweat, and tears on something, and now that chapter is over. So it doesn't make you the happiest, because you are kind of like sad about that as well, right? So that's why it's always so bittersweet, that moment. But when I look back, like, you know, the moments that, like, you know, the first time you get something are normally the very happy moments you remember. Like, you know, the first time I got the funding, like, you know, I was a first time founder in my, you know, late 20s at that time, you know, trying to raise capital for the idea I had. And it was hard. Like, you know, I had like a lot of VCs will reject me and say, you know, it's too early to, you know, market not large enough, whatever, all kind of reasons. Like, so the first time I got an offer from an investor, I knew the company is real now, because I have some money to get the company going, right? So that was definitely a very happy moment. I remember the, you know, first time we closed a paying customer, like, you know, and you get the check. Like, those days you used to get physical checks. Like, now you get the money in the wire in the bank, but you used to get physical checks. So, you know, you get the physical check. I still remember the picture of it, like, you know, took a picture, framed it, like, you know, that's the first money you get from the customer. I really think I really remember, like, you know, another moment when, like, you know, where you feel the difference you make to a customer. Like, you know, when say customers, like, when someone says, like, you know, okay, you guys have made a big difference to what we do, like, you know, right, to our business, to my, you know, in AppDynamics, we're selling, like, you know, a product for people to monitor and troubleshoot problems in software fast, right? So, you know, the users will say, okay, this makes my life easy, and I'm really happy. And you hear that, it's okay, you fulfilled something that you set out to do. You know, and then in the end, I would say, I get very happy when, like, you know, I still, like, you know, when AppDynamics got acquired by Cisco, we had about, like, you know, 400 people who made more than $1 million, and many people who made, like, you know, $5 million plus. And so it was a, you know, a great outcome for, like, you know, employees. And that's something, you know, I take a lot of pride in. But I also, even now, I get sometimes messages, hey, we just bought a new house from the, you know, the money we made in AppDynamics. And, like, those are, like, still happy moments that, like, you know, okay, we were successful as a company, but, like, we made impact in our employees and people's lives. Yeah.
That's awesome. That is so awesome. So Harness is now valued at $3.7 billion as well. There's a number again. How do you, you know, you've been very successful, and one of the things that I certainly implement, try to forget your last success, right? Because everyone is you're a different person, and the company is different, right? So how is your approach different with Harness versus AppDynamics? Because you're a different leader now, right?
Yeah. Well, I'm a different leader, but also, you know, the markets are different, the products are different, the competitive dynamics is different, you know, and the times are different too. Like, you know, how your customers do things are different than, like, what they used to do 10 years ago. So I'm a strong believer in what you said as well. Like, you know, it doesn't matter, like, you know, what you did before. It's you know, your customers don't really care. You know, you're you have to still build the best products. You have to compete in the market. You have to, you know, do right execution. There's some advantages you get as a second time, you know, CEO, that, you know, you can recruit better, you can attract more talent, fundraising is much easier. It's not like, you know, I had to pitch 30 VCs to get my first check. You know, it's the 30 VCs were knocking on my door to give me the check. So that part becomes easier. But everything else is the same. You still have to find product market fit. The product market fit part doesn't change. It's equally hard every time. You know, the part of, like, you know, competing in the market and, you know, getting customers to care for what you're doing, you know, finding, you know, more products to build as you're, you know, to grow the market. All those things are still the same that you have to navigate. But I look at, like, you know, there are a few things I like to keep constant. You know, for me, like, you know, when I look back at, like, you know, what works for me as my formula, and I call it, like, my simple 5-point formula. But it comes down to, like, you know, make sure that, you know, we keep expanding our TAM, like our total addressable market. We keep expanding. It's already large and we keep expanding, because if you do that, then life becomes easier because you have more and more, you know, larger and larger market to go after. You know, I like to make sure that, like, you know, our product has to be in the, you know, in the top three in our space. Like, whatever area market use cases we are going after, we have to be in the top three. You know, ideally number one, number two, but, you know, sometimes hard to know what's number one, what's number two, but let's say we are in top three. You know, we build very strong sales execution, you know, around our product. So it's not just the product, but the sales is exceptionally strong. You know, fourth is we really take care of customers and not just say it. Every company says it, but, you know, it's like a, it's just a checkbox, but you, like, really, really take care of customers. And then fifth, you create, like, a good open collaborative culture, like, you know, culture where, like, you know, people are, you know, they, you know, people like to be part of the company because it's open, it's transparent, it's collaborative, people are in together. And I look at, if those five things are there, you know, I'm happy running the business because I know, like, you know, that's the business I enjoy. And everything else, then you adapt and figure out, right? You know, what's in the, and which is very different for every time. So those I would think, like, you know, top level things I look at between AppDynamics and Harness and Traceable, like, you know, in my, all my companies are about the same.
That's awesome. So there's some commonalities. You keep your guiding principles or whatever tenets, whatever you want to call it, mm-hmm. constant, but mm-hmm. then morph everything around that, right? And it's also you having fun when you're doing these things.
Yeah, you know, you don't want to be operating in an environment where you don't, it's against your guiding principles. And, you know, different people have different guiding principles for me, but those are the, like, you know, some people might want to enjoy running a company that's low growth and, you know, but say, you know, I don't enjoy it. For me, it's like, you know, I like to enjoy, like, you know, we're building new products, we're growing our TAM, we are expanding our platform, and we kind of, you know, growing. And that's more fun for me. So, you know, if we get to a point where, you know, that's not possible, you know, I will stop having fun in that company.
Yeah, no, for sure. That's and you know, I think I'm and this is a good segue into my next question, because that is truly what a mission orientation is about, right? Because if you're mission oriented and it's not a job, right, then you're going to say, hey, the mission was to create a high growth company that affected as many customers as possible, right, across the board. And that's not being successful. Maybe we should do something else, right? Pivot to doing something else. And that orientation, it's not about abandoning your current mission, but it's about pivoting to a new one, right? And I think a lot of people miss that, right? Because if it's a job, then you're like, okay, I'm fine at 15% growth. It's just the way it is. The markets are hard.
No, that's the thing. And you know, also, it's different. Different people have different strengths. Like, you know, so you have to play to your strength. Like, you know, in my case, I look at my strength as, you know, building more products and expanding markets and going after, like, a high growth, you know, kind of mission, serving bigger and bigger, you know, aspect of the market. And so I have to play to that strength. Like, you know, if your business, you know, changes, obviously you morph and you pivot and you go into different things, but, you know, then you are in a spot where, like, you know, you're not playing to your strengths. And then maybe you need to surround yourself or bring more people who are better on those strengths, and you have to be humble about that too, right?
Yeah, no, I think that's awesome. So let's, from the mission orientation thing that we're talking about, let's talk about people, right? Because it is about people, like you said. So hiring the right people is critical. It's obvious. What's the one question you ask every candidate?
Hmm.
It doesn't matter what function.
Yeah. That's a good question. I like to see what people are proud of. You know, that's the one question I always like, because that tells me a lot of what is their core strength and what they want to build was like, you know. So I normally like to ask, like, you know, what are you most proud of that you have done in your career, you know? And people have different kind of things. Like, you know, sometimes people will be, I'm very proud of the team I built. You know, sometimes people will be like, I'm very proud of, you know, this very complex technical problem we solved. You know, sometimes people will be like, you know, I'm very proud of these, hard results we were able to achieve that, you know. And that kind of tells you about people, like, you know, how they think, like, you know, what will drive them and what will make them proud.
For sure. I think that's a great tip for our listeners, right? Which is just at the end of the day, you know, they are trying to see if they fit into the mission that you're driving, and you're trying to figure out if they fit into the mission as well. And for them to know more about the mission and you, the leader, and for you to know more about how they fit and a little bit more about them, the people, rather than the skills, is really important, right? It shows you what's important to them.
Yeah, exactly. And it's very also important, like, you know, for us to understand, like, and as a, when you're hiring someone, like, you know, what would make people successful and proud 3-4 years from now, right? You know, is our job aligned with that? If not, like, you know, they're likely not going to be happy and excited about that.
No, I agree. So one of the, we talked about mission orientation. What would be your tip to leaders, right? About what are techniques you've used to make sure that you get the point across that it is not about individual accomplishment, it is about the team winning, right? I talk about this concept called the no-look pass. Uh-huh. Right, you can score a goal, you can score a basket, but you choose not to, mm-hmm. right? And you say that the other person actually has a higher likelihood of making it happen, and so give them the ball, pass them the ball, whatever it is, right? Mm-hmm. And that's in my mind at least focus on the team, i.e., the mission winning, right? What are some things that you have done to make sure that mission orientation shows up in your teams?
Well. To me, there are three parts of it. One is setting the mission very clear, like, you know, that people know what the mission is. Like, so when we look at like, say, AppDynamics, my first company, you know, the mission we set was the whole world is running on code. Can we go and instrument every line of code so, you know, the developers who are writing that code can watch it? Like, so it was a big mission that, you know, that we want to instrument every line of code in the world, and, you know, that allows developers to, you know, fix problems when that happens in the code. You know, in my new company, Harness, our mission is, you know, that we have, there are 30 million developers in the world. Can we make them 20-30% more efficient, you know, by bringing them the right developer tools for, you know, do their job on, like, building code and testing code and deploying code and everything around it, right? So now making 30 million developers in the world 20-30% more efficient is a clear mission that we keep building towards, right? And, you know, rest will come from it. So that's, like, one part of the mission, like, you know, that you define. I also like to define, like, a almost a path, like a financial path, like, you know, which is, say, you know, a path to, you know, let's say when we're starting, you know, path to our first 100 million of ARR, like, and we say, okay, this is the path we want to shoot for, like, you know, we go from roughly from this to this in 5 years, or, like, you know, some number, and say, okay, now it's the path to $1 billion of ARR, and we go from here to here in this many years. So people can see it, like, you know, that's our mission is to, you know, to do achieve something, but there's a financial business path that is tied to it, and with the financial goal as well. And we're not going to follow the path exactly, but at least there's something that people have in their head and all the time, right? So that's to me is the first part. The second part is communicating that. And communicating that, I've learned over time, like, you know, the hard way, that you have to do it, like, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times. And, you know, to the point when people get bored of it, like, you know, when people say, okay, stop it, I've heard it many times. That to me is a good time that people have to know, like, you know, otherwise, like, as the companies get larger and larger, like, you know, you just lost the clarity around it. So the, you know, that strategic repetition of a few things you want to be, like, that is very, very, that is very clear. That's the second part. The third part is, like, you know, make a collective mission after that, you know, that people, once, you know, you define a clear mission, you know, you make sure that mission is communicated clearly all the time and many times. And third, it becomes a collective mission, that it's not your mission or, like, a few people's mission, it's everyone is in the same mission. Like, you know, it's the, You know, I really like to see it when like every employee believes in the mission, like, you know, to the point that it's not even a question. Like, you know, it's more about like, you know, people talk about like, hey, you know, in our plan, we want to be there, but we need to fix these things in over the next 2-3 years to do this. And like, you know, even though maybe the youngest, earliest in the career employee is talking about those, that means like, you know, it's, they all part of that. Like, so it's, that's, then it becomes the, almost like a collective destiny as well, because, you know, everyone is thinking about it and like everyone, you know, you have like collective brain power, around it. People are you're questioning if you're not on the right path, et cetera, right? So, you know, I look at it from those three things, like define the mission clearly, communicate it like as many times as possible. So it's there's no confusion on what the mission is, and like a sort of a high level path, because otherwise it's believable that it's possible, right? You know, and then make it a collective mission.
That's awesome. That is gold. That's a phenomenal way to think about it. By the way, I say this as well, which is you have to say it enough that you are bored, and then say it for another 3 months, mm-hmm. Because you're going to get bored of it yourself. But remember, the teams don't get bored, right? So I think that's a mm-hmm. great true north. So I'm going to shift a little bit and talk a little bit about AI, and I want to take it in two different directions here. So. I'm as excited about generative AI as I was, actually more excited about generative AI and predictive AI today than I was with the browser in 94, mm-hmm. right? Because I think it's going to affect every industry, and the pace at which it's going to happen is going to be bigger, and it's going to have a bigger impact on almost everything quicker. Do you agree with that statement, and what are your thoughts on it?
I 100% agree. Like, you know, it's a disruptive moment in the evolution of technology. You know, it's the way browser was and internet was and, you know, mobile was, you know, generative AI is. Like, it can definitely help redefine and change how so many of different job disciplines are done, from programming code to like writing content to helping customers and, you know, doing sales. Almost all, every discipline has a massive transformational impact that's possible, and the pace is extremely, extremely, extremely high. That's why it's so disruptive. Like, and it's not like, you know, like some technologies, like, you know, okay, that will take 10 years for the technology to become mature. Like, this is like in 6 months we are like, you know, the disruption happening. Another 6 months, you know, it's like it will be a different world.
And I also think that, you know, this time around, a lot of people don't get this. I think, you know, if you just think about the announcement that Google made with the EU this morning, right? I mean, and OpenAI is, we're not sure about it. But my point is, there's a discussion happening very quickly. No one talked about regulating the internet in 1994, right? So I think the pace at which I think governments are going to work is also going to be dramatically different than anything they've ever done before. Yeah. Because the pace of innovation is like breathtaking, right? Yeah, yeah. So Jyoti, here's my, Harness is an AI company. You're going to, you know, you've been doing that for a while. You're going to double down on it, obviously, right? You were using many, many techniques. Now, you know, you can leverage LLMs and things like that. And not to say that you weren't doing those, but a large portion of us as a leader is to maybe, you know, practice what we preach. Uh-huh. Right. So as you think about your companies, mm-hmm. right, it's going to disrupt those functions as well. Mm-hmm. You lead? How do you get folks within your company to kind of say, hey, we need to lead the charge, mm-hmm. right? We need to make sure that we are AI first across all mm-hmm. functions as well.
Yeah. You know, when I look at, say, in my companies, it's, you know, we have the people are smart. They're reading all the news. They follow, like, you know, how big impactful it is. So you don't really have to tell them that, like, you know, it's a big deception. But how do we get it all jump started and, like, you know, that we have to be leading the charge on it? You know, so one thing that we did at Harness, and we are doing at my other company Traceable now, is to do a company wide hackathon. We did a company wide hackathon all on generative AI. Like, you know, so everyone in Harness was, you know, 3 days. You know, do a hackathon, you know, build something, you know, using generative AI for, you know, in you know, features in our product to innovate, you know, something, how we can help our customers better, how can we go to do market better, all during generative AI. At Harness, we had like 54 projects came out of it. You know, it's like, so you have this like rich library of 54 ideas, and you know, half of them are already working in 3 days, you know, so because hackathons are very powerful ways to get things going, right? You know, and then, but what it also did, it is like, you know, everyone was educated in LLMs and generative AI, like, because everyone worked on it for 3 days, and we essentially give everyone go and, you know, and compete and do it, you know, and work on it. And so it's like everyone now is very educated and aware on generative AI. They understand what, like, you know, what's possible, what not possible, to, like, you know, to some extent. And now we are, you know, we have so many, like, a rich library of ideas to also go and look at productizing, right? So that's a strategy, you know, that I've used to kind of get the whole company behind it and get excited and get involved around it. And it has gone well for us.
This is, Jyoti, this is awesome. I feel like we've not even explored the product side and the tech side of this. So at some point, we'll have to do this again. Mm-hmm. But I want to, like, pivot a little bit and actually go through some rapid questions, mm-hmm. Obviously brought to you by GPT, right? So so the first question, what's the most interesting fact you know?
What's the most interesting fact I know?
I should say the one that's not most obvious, right? Because we all know a lot of things, right? Yeah. So what would be a good one?
You know, I like to read history a lot, you know, and I always get fascinated by the Roman Empire and how long it could last, like, you know, even after the eastern part of the Roman Empire versus the western part of the Roman Empire. It's like fascinating to see, like, you know, your empire lasting 1600 years, you know, and, you know, but what get the empire last is like the foundations you built around it, like the principles, the institutions, like they keep going and going and going, like, you know, even when the people go away and the, you know, that's like, you know, those are a lot of fascinating facts that I know and I love to read.
That's awesome. Yeah. One book everyone should read.
You know, I would say when you are getting new to the business, you know, someone early, I always loved, you know, the Good to Great. You know, it's just you know, simple book, but gets you a sense of, like, you know, what does it mean to have a, you know, a great company and a great business, and what's the difference in a good business and a great business.
What's an unpopular opinion you have about leadership?
I don't believe in this kind of a high degree of command and control kind of leadership, and sometimes it could be unpopular. You know, I believe in, you know, you gotta, as long as you create alignment on the mission and create measurability and accountability, people figure things out, and people do a pretty good job, you know. So many times people don't, you know, find that as a popular leadership style, but, you know, that's something I strongly believe in, because it's so much better, like, you know, hundreds of brains are much better than one or two brains. So that works so much better for me.
What's the hardest truth you've had to accept?
You know, I should have looked at your script before.
These questions are really good. you know, like, I think a good example would be, I'm human, right?
Well, the hardest truth is along those lines. Like, you know, you have to figure out what your strengths and what your weaknesses are. And, like, you know, you know, it's, you can spend a lot of time, like, fixing your weaknesses, but I feel like, you know, the best use of your time is to maximize your strengths, and, like, you know, surround you with other people who have the other strengths that you're not very strong on, you know. Then it's like, you know, then you have this people with superpowers, like, you know, you find your superpower and you just focus on that mostly, and you bring people with other superpowers around you, and then you have, you know, a very strong group of people.
One piece of advice you would tell your younger self?
One piece of advice for my younger self is, you know, I think it's learn, you know, broaden what you want to learn. You know, the earlier you learn more things, the better it is. Like, you know, and when you start on thing and you want to become good at something, you focus on that one area. But I do think, like, you know, the more time you spend on learning different things, and I look at, like, you know, learning business, learning, you know, markets, learning, you know, the people, behaviors, dynamics, you know, it's you know, I wish I started putting more energy and time in learning things earlier.
That's awesome. That's great. That's good advice. Jyoti, thank you very much for joining our podcast. I think our listeners are going to have a blast listening to this. And don't be surprised if we have you come back again. Thank you very much for doing this.
Yeah, it was great to be here, and really good questions here.
Thanks, Jyoti.